just one big story, isn't it?
Welcome to the Story Connection. I'm your host, Dänna Wilberg. Tonight we have a very special guest. It's the program coordinator for the fabulous entertaining Stories on Stage. Welcome, Sue Stat.
Well, thank you for asking me, Dänna. This is great. I'm so happy to be on Story Connection.
Well, I'm so happy to have you here from Stories on Stage.
Well, yeah.
I would love for you to tell the viewers all about it, because it's one of my favorite things to do in Sacramento and in Davis.
Well, yes. The Sacramento Stories on Stage started about 5 years ago. We're celebrating our fifth year. It's where actors read short stories, or sometimes segments of novels. We invite writers. We invite an established writer, which is somebody who is a well-known author who's published a book with a recognized publisher. And we also invite what we call the emerging writer, who's sort of everybody else. It's people like me, who's published a couple of stories in literary magazines, but I haven't quite got my book published yet. And so we invite these two writers, and then we have a casting director who finds just the right actor to read the story for our audience. And it's been going for 5 years now. Mm-hmm. We are celebrating our fifth year. And our 6th year is coming up starting in January. So we're very excited about that.
Now, where do you have this performance?
Well, it takes place at the Sacramento Poetry Center, which is in the Arts Complex at 25th and R Streets. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a smallish location, so if we have a better known writer, mm-hmm. We'll often get a larger venue, because this Poetry Center holds about 50 to 60 people maybe, but in the last large event we had 120 people. So,
oh my goodness.
I know. It was
the writer?
The writer is Anthony Mara, and He is a very well-known young writer whose debut novel is called A Constellation of Vital Phenomena. Mm. And it was a spectacular success. And we had him come, and we held it at Verge Center for the Arts, which was a way bigger location. And the actress Ruby Sketchy read his part of his novel, and it was just a wonderful night. An enormous number of people came out to hear him, and the literary community is really excited to have this sort of facility available to do this sort of thing.
Yeah. Well, we have a clip.
Yes, we do. Ruby is reading a little bit of Anthony's novel called A Constellation of Vital Phenomena.
Great. Well, let's take a look.
Even though the villagers overcame their fear of the pedophilic specter, though many wouldn't let their children enter, and even though their lives were undeniably improved by the presence of a clinic, Ahmed always felt he had let them down, or at least let himself down, by returning to the village that had celebrated his escape. But after applying to 23 different hospital positions and receiving not one interview, he was today, finally, a physician at hospital number 6, and not only a physician, but third in command. Well, when put like that, it was a higher honor than he could have ever imagined. He trekked along the service road more confidently than he had that morning, and imagined what those smug search committees would have to say about it. They probably wouldn't say anything. They were probably all dead. In this way, the war was an equalizer, the first true Chechen meritocracy. He was an incompetent doctor, but a decent man, he believed, compensating for his professional limitations with his empathy for the patient, his understanding of pain. Passing the field where the wolf's frozen carcass lay in moonlight, he thought of Marx. Perhaps here was where history had reached its final epoch. A civilization without class, property, state, or law. Perhaps this was the end. The final 50 meters through the village were the most dangerous of the 11-kilometer slog. His footsteps, if overheard, could prove as lethal as landmines. He slowed as he approached the only house without blackout curtains. The light of generator-powered bulbs burned through the windows. Ramzan, sitting inside, picking at a shiny slice of meat, didn't look like an informer or a collaborator. looked no more menacing than a man in the throes of a mighty indigestion. In the next window, Kassan, Ramzan's father, sat reading at his desk. Kassan hadn't spoken to his son in the 2 years since Ramzan had begun informing, and though Ahmed never blamed the old man for his son's crimes, the electric bulbs bathed both in the same light. The glow of their house shrank to a glimmer as he reached his own. The door frame was intact. The door still stood. Opening it, he tensed, waiting for a forceful grip on the shoulder, a rifle butt to the forehead. None came. He lit a kerosene lamp and walked into the bedroom. Ula lay on the bed. She rolled on her side and into the yellow glow.
"Where were you?"
she asked. Divorced from tone, the three words still suggested accusation, and he hoped his silence would extinguish her question as it often did.
"Where were you?"
she asked again. Her head barely indented the pillow.
"I went to see Doc Ah," he said. "I helped him shear the sheep."
She smiled wide enough to show the tips of her teeth. 12 years earlier, those incisors were beloved by the city dentist, a young man who plugged his most lascivious thoughts into the open mouths of young women. But the dentist died a virgin when a misaimed mortar shell landed on his practice and carried him to paradise in an erupting gray cloud.
"Doka is so impatient," she murmured. "If he waited a month, the flock would give more wool."
"Yes," he agreed. "Doka was always impatient." He sat on the bed and set the lantern next to the bedpan and the broth bowl. Each was half full. An ellipsis of wet footprints followed him to the bed. He unlaced his icy boots, massaged the balls of his feet, and lay beside Ula. Once she would have had to roll over to make room for him, but there was less of her now.
"How is his family?"
"They are well," he said. He turned onto his side and slid his left hand beneath her nightshirt to warm his fingers on her stomach.
"They should eat with us soon."
So what got you started with Stories on Stage?
Well, I've been involved with Stories on Stage for about 2 years now, but Stories on Stage was started in 2009 by the Sacramento writer Valerie Fioravanti, whose collection of short stories, Garbage Night at the Opera, was a prize winner a couple of years ago. But Valerie moved to town and didn't know any writers at all. There are lots of things, lots of venues where poets can read their work or where people can hear poetry read. But she asked around and said, "Well, where do the short story writers, where do the literary fiction writers meet?" And they said, "Oh, there's no place in here. You'll have to go to the Bay Area." And Valerie said, "Oh, no, I'm not going to do that." And so what she did was start this Stories on Stage, which is modeled after an NPR show called Selected Shorts, where actors read short stories. And she started this, and you gathered a bunch of people, found some actors to start to read the stories, and just went to the Poetry Center and asked if she could use their venue. And they said yes. They've been incredibly supportive and helpful of us in this whole time. And it got started, and it started building and building and building, and pretty soon people were noticing. The News and Review has named it. It was has been a reader's choice of places to go to hear literary fiction for 5 years in a row now with the Sacramento News and Review, and it's been honored by a couple of other places as well. So that's how it got started, and it went on, and I got involved when I was asked to read at a reading that was sort of sponsored by Stories on Stage, and I met Valerie then, and she was very intrigued with my story and asked me to submit another one, which I did. So I had a story read there, and then we became friends. And about, I'm thinking a little over a year ago, she'd been doing it for 4 years, and she's a writer, and she's trying to, and as am I, she's trying to get her collection finished, and she said, "Would you take this over?" She said, neither of us wanted it to end, but she was just up to her ears in stuff. So I said, "Okay, I'll do it." So I have been the coordinator for it ever since, and it's been really interesting and really fun, and I've met a lot of writers I probably wouldn't have met any other way, and it's been just, it's a real literary hub for Sacramento, and it has, in the 5 years of its existence, established a place where fiction writers can go and hear great stories beautifully told.
Well, let's talk about the process.
Okay.
How do you, from start to finish, how do you put it all together?
How do I put it all together? Oh, my gosh. Well, I have this checklist that's about a mile long. No, the first thing we need to do is find writers. Mm-hmm. So, and we have, as I said, the established writer and the emerging writers. So the first thing I do is invite established writers, people who I know have books coming out, people who are friendly toward us or who've been referred to me by somebody. And I will just, I email them and I say, would you like to come to Sacramento for essentially no money and you have to get yourself here? But we need you to be there because the writer gets up and before the story is read, they talk a little bit about the story and tell us sort of how they wrote it and how they came to be. And then we also have a bookseller there. The Avid Reader is our bookseller. And we sell books. A lot of people buy them so they hang around and they sign copies and meet the people who are there to see them and hear their work. So that's the first thing I do. And then I do through the same process with my emerging writers. Mm-hmm. Only that is people just send me stories. Mm-hmm. And I pick them. I find a story that works. Mm-hmm. And just in case people are thinking about sending a story, the stories that work are stories that are 3,500 to 4,500 words long. Literary fiction, which is different than young adult fiction. Mm-hmm. It's a more, you know, sort of character based and kind of a smaller story in a way. But most, if the story has great characters and lots of good dialogue and good scenes, then it'll work really well for stories on stage because it'll be something that the actors can get their teeth into. Yeah. You know. So that's, and then once I have my writers, then I set my schedule. We're on the final Friday of every month at the Poetry Center, as I said, and we have a blog, Stories on Stage Sacramento, and I put information out on the blog, and we have a Facebook page, Stories on Stage Sacramento, yeah. And I put information out on that, and we have an email list, and I invite people. So next, I start promoting it, mm-hmm. And I send information, of course, to the media, and I do shows like yours that let people know that it's here and where you can get information.
Yes, and for those of you out there who've never been, it's a real treat. If you're a reader or a writer, this is something you must do.
It's really fun.
It is fun.
Yeah, think about how much fun it was when you were a child and someone read a story to you. You know, this duplicates it in a way you could just sit and you hear these wonderful actors, mm-hmm. all from the Sacramento area,
yeah.
Reading these stories, which are all, everything, they're different every time, but they're fascinating because they're very well read, and it's just a wonderful, wonderful evening I don't know, I love it. I love it every time. It's always a surprise to me, and we always have a really good time.
So how do you pick the voice to match the work?
Well, I wish I could say, I would have to give all the credit to Peggy Wood, who's our she selects all the actors. Mm. She's our casting director. And she knows a lot of people in Sacramento, a lot of actors in Sacramento. Mm-hmm. So she gets the story, she reads the story, and then she'll immediately think of three or four actors who will be perfect for it. So that's how we select it. And sometimes we have to do something slightly different, like this coming in November, we had a story that had two characters, two narrators, and one of them was a woman who was deaf and had turned off her hearing aid. So a lot of the dialogue was just not hearing, mm-hmm. what the person was saying. So we used two actors to read that, so we could have one to react, one to act. It was a very, very interesting problem,
wow.
in the story, yeah. that Peggy solved very creatively. So that's how the actors get selected.
Well, the ones that I've attended, mm-hmm. were just so spectacularly read, the
right.
different voices, the
right.
different parts. And what better way but, you know, having an actor who is well versed in playing different characters.
That's right.
Because
right.
the character really comes out,
right.
in the different parts,
right.
and it's just incredible.
Well, an actor can find the sort of the emotion and the, mm. voice in a story, where authors are often very good readers of their work. They kind of have to be. They have to do it so much,
yes.
as you know. But an actor will find something often deeper and more emotional. They'll find threads and themes in a story that even the writer doesn't know about. So interestingly, I've been able to get some writers that I never thought I'd be able to get, mostly because they are very curious to hear their work read. Mm-hmm. Many of them have never heard their work read by anybody other than themselves. So the voice they hear in the work is their own. But when they hear an actor, they're often thrilled. Some are emotionally very involved.
Yes.
Some are, it's really interesting, and they all find it a wonderful experience. And as a result, they talk it up to their friends, and as a result, we have some really wonderful, better and better and more well-known writers coming to Sacramento. We do pay a small honorarium for our writers and our actors, but it's nothing near where they could get on, say, the lecture circuit. It's not the $10,000 they might be able to get on a lecture circuit.
Well, because this is the story behind the story.
Right.
Let's talk a little bit more about you, Sue.
About me?
Yeah,
oh, okay.
Let's talk a little bit more about you. What inspires you to write? What inspires you to do what you do?
Oh, I guess I've, like a lot of writers who are sort of late to writing, I spent my career, I worked in television earlier, as I think I shared with you, and I worked in sales and I worked in marketing, and then I retired, and I spent a lot of my life writing other people's material or writing for other people. And once I retired, I thought, I think I'll do this for myself. So I started writing stories, and all those things I've been making up for years and years and years in my head, and all the stories I couldn't tell when I was a journalist, you know, all sort of the truth
really
behind things,
yeah,
or the endings you really wanted to have happen. That's why I write. I guess you could categorize my work as literary fiction. I'm really interested in sort of the small things that happen between people. I write about, you know, my own age group, which is something that isn't particularly usual, but it's actually quite a bit of interest to people. So
any topics or characters that you...
Oh, it's just, I'd write a lot about relationships between people once the fire has gone, you know, and how difficult that is to sustain, and when it is either sustained or when it's not sustained. I write about, I really like odd things to happen to people, so many odd things happen to my characters. I have one of mine is a sort of a love story between a girl and her giant African tortoise. I mean, it's not really a love story's love story, but it's their relationship. And so I love relationships, and I kind of don't care who they're between. I just really enjoy writing about that. It's a fun exploration for me, you know.
So do you write every day?
I'd really love to say that I write every day, and I try to. I think if I'm not writing, I'm thinking about it, which is kind of a cop-out, but I could be better disciplined, but I don't think there's a writer alive who says that they could, feels that they are as disciplined as they need to be about it.
So do you intentionally set out to write, or do you just something spark your imagination?
At this point, I'm working on a short story collection.
So oh, good. Okay.
Yeah. So I have, many of them are written, and I'm revising right now, which is like torture. And I really do have a task ahead of me. I don't have to. I'm not waiting for inspiration. What I'm waiting for is It is like inspiration, but it's a different kind of inspiration. I know what's wrong with this. Now, how can I make it better? You know, it's that kind of inspiration. It's not what happens next. It's okay. How can I really make this work?
Do you belong to a critique group?
I do. I have a couple of them.
Okay.
I do an online group. There's an online group, and I go to a lot of workshops.
Mm-hmm.
There's an excellent series of workshops called the Master Teacher Workshops that actually Valerie, who started Stories on Stage, started. And there are three or four of those, and I go to three or four of those a year. I have friends I send stories to. I completed a master's degree. I went through an MFA program and finished that several years ago. So I have friends from that all over the country, and I'll send my stories to them. So yes, I think any writer needs readers. You,
yeah.
I bet you have readers.
I do.
Yeah. People who read your work and say, it's working, or I love this, or maybe you could, blah, blah, you know.
Well, I just published my first book
this
October.
That's right, I know that. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Fantastic.
So that was very thrilling for me.
I know.
And so I know the angst.
I know. Well, you know, someday I will publish my first book as well. I have published a number of short stories in literary magazines, but there's nothing like your book. So congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, this is about you. So where do you see Stories on Stage going? Do you have a big vision for it? Do you expect it to grow into something that...
You know, I have a little vision for it. Okay. And I think the little vision for it right now is that Stories on Stage was started by one person, and it was sort of all the work of one person. And what I am trying to do is to set it up so that it is more of a spread out effort. So I have a committee now. Instead of choosing the writers all myself, I have a committee and we select the writers. We say, we'd love this person, we'd love this person, we'd love this person. And then we read their stories and select them. So I have other people doing some of that. Peggy's my casting director. I don't have to do that. So what I'm trying to do is make it into more of a community-based organization rather than just, you know, my reading series that I am completely responsible for, because frankly I don't want to do it. I don't want to be completely responsible for it forever. So that's what I'm doing, and it's so the decisions we're making are, do we become a real nonprofit, or do we continue to be a nonprofit sort of in the shelter of the Sacramento Poetry Center, and do we get a larger venue and invite bigger and bigger writers? Well, we kind of started that this year. I'm at the point where I'm going to tell you who some of next year's writers are. This is exciting.
Listen up, everybody.
This is exciting. Our season opener on January 30th of 2015 is the writer Tobias Wolff, whom you may have heard of as a man who wrote This Boy's Life. Mm-hmm. He's well known as a memoirist and also as a short story writer. He's an icon of writing. He's somebody who is just amazingly, his stories just, well, they knocked me out. That's all I can say. So we're thrilled to get him. The other two well-known writers that I have are Ann Packer, who wrote The Dive from Clausen's Pier, and she has another book coming out called The Children's Crusade, which is kind of about California. So she's coming out. And then the next person we have who is well-known is Adam Johnson, who wrote the Orphan Master's Son, which is it was a best-selling novel and he won the Pulitzer Prize for it. It's a Pulitzer Prize winner we're getting. He's our first Pulitzer Prize winner, I think. So anyway, those are the three biggest writers we have coming so far, but there's some others in the works. And then we have other writers who are presenting their second book with us. So we're starting to get repeat writers, and it's an exciting season coming up, and I think you're going to be we're going to get some bigger venues for those writers, and I think you'll probably be seeing some good publicity about them too. So I'm really excited about this coming season. But I think bigger writers, some grants maybe, so we can pay a little more, because you know getting paid for your writing is really important. It's one of the things that Valerie thought was the most important when she started the series, and so we do. Paying the actor, exactly.
That's
exactly.
A new thing too.
Well, the way it used to be was that people, we ask a $5 donation at the door, and at the end of the evening, Valerie gather all the money and just split it four ways.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes they'd get $20. The first time I had a reading, she handed me $25. I'd never been paid for my writing. And what? Money! It was wonderful.
Oh.
It's really important to recognize writers and actors in that way, I think.
Well, Sue, we're running out of time,
believe
it or not. So let's give your information so people know how to get in contact with the information they need to attend.
Okay.
Stories on Stage.
Okay. Stories on Stage is the final Friday of every month at the Sacramento Poetry Center. And anybody who wants information about it can find it on our Stories on Stage blog, which is Stories on Stage Sacramento. If you Google Stories on Stage Sacramento, the blog will come up. We have a Facebook page, Stories on Stage Sacramento, that you can like, and you will get all the information from it. And you can also sign up to get the newsletter by email, which is basically once a month that says, here's what the show's going to be, you're invited, please come. And it tells you a lot about the writers and about the actors, so you have a little information about it. So,
that's so great.
And we hope everybody will come and hear these wonderful stories.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the Story Connection, shall we?
The Story Connection airs the second and fourth Thursday at 9:30 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Our companion show, Paranormal Connection, airs the first and third Thursdays of each month. Each episode repeats the following Friday at 1:30 p.m. and Saturday at 5:30 a.m. You can watch these programs online at the same airtimes by going to accesssacramento.org and clicking Watch 17, or you can watch us on Comcast Channel 17 in the Sacramento region and on AT&T Channel 99. For information on upcoming shows and previous Story Connection guests, go to storyconnectiontv.blogspot.com. You can contact us at storyconnectiontv@gmail.com. And don't forget, join us on Facebook, become a friend, and become a fan.
So Sue, in the couple minutes that we have left,
okay,
anything that you'd like to share that we didn't cover?
I can't think of anything. I think we covered everything. The upcoming season, mm-hmm, that was exciting, that's important. And how people can find out where Stories on Stage is, right?
Facebook.
Facebook, right. Facebook. If you like Stories on Stage Sacramento on Facebook, that is the best way to get the most information, mm-hmm, about us.
And you also have clips on YouTube?
We do.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about that.
We record every, mm-hmm, reading. And post it on YouTube. I do all that too. So.
Oh, wow.
It's not very high quality, but it is there for anybody who wants to miss the event, uh-huh, and wants to have just spend a little time with a really good story, well read.
Great.
Yeah.
Well, we're just about out of time. I want to thank everybody out there for tuning into Story Connection, and we're always out and about looking for a new story. So if we come up to you and ask you what your story is, I hope you're prepared, because it's all about the story. So thank you again for coming on, and I wish you the best of luck with Stories on Stage coming up.
I wish you all kinds of luck with Story Connection. This is a terrific way to get, it's a terrific service for this community, and I appreciate it.
Well, you're welcome. Thank you so much. Yeah. With that said, we're going to say goodnight.